am I audible?
Yes, you are audible, Gaurav.
Today's presentation is on pediatric ECG. I am just sharing the basics of pediatric ECG in a very simple way, along with few case scenarios that we are seeing in day-to-day practice. A few disclosure, few of the shown slides are taken from my colleagues. As we all know, the physical examination, X-ray and ECG forms the triad for making the clinical diagnosis of congenital heart disease. ECG may or may not be helpful in making the diagnosis, but it is helpful in follow-up patients, especially in post-op cases. And these are the conditions in which the ECG can be helpful to identify the cardiac malposition, whether cytosolitis or inversus, extra or levocardia, different of congenital heart diseases, ventricular or atrial hypertrophy, pericardial or myocardial diseases, electrolyte imbalance, and various types of arrhythmias. But there are challenges in pediatric age group because the different ranges are available for different age group of various ECG parameters. Pattern which is normal for one group may be abnormal for other group. As we all know, in neonatal age group and first few years of the life, right ventricular dominance is there. Axis is generally directed rightward with degree of 120 degree. But between 1 month to 3 years, ECG is intermediate. And CSD and post-repair ECG may have different patterns. Yeah, as we all know, there are three limb leads, named as bipolar limb leads 1, 2, and 3, and augmented unipolar leads like ABR, ABL, and ABF. And there are 6 precordial leads, V1 to V6. But in pediatric age group, there are right-sided leads also, especially in case of dextrocardia, known as RV3 or RV4. This is a cartoon showing the lead one is directed horizontally from here to here. This is the negative, this is the positive. I will show in the next slide, and the V1 to V6 oriented like this. This is the direction of lead one. It is a horizontal lead from minus is on the right side and positive on the left side. Lead two is directed from right arm to left leg. Right arm is negative and left leg is positive. And lead three is from left arm, which is negative, to leg, that is left leg, that is positive. This constitutes the intervening triangle. If the wave of depolarization spreads towards the recording electrode, this results in the positive deflection and vice versa. For example, if the current is going towards here, then it will record the positive. If it is going here, it will record the positive. Otherwise, it will record negative here and negative here. How do we place the lead on the chest, especially in case of V1 to V6? V1 is on the right fourth intercostal space. V2 is on the left-sided fourth intercostal space. V4 is in the fifth intercostal space at the left mid-clavicular line. And V3 in between 2 and 4. And V5 at the anterior axillary line, and V6 is the mid-axillary line. Few words about the ECG paper. In the y-axis, we measure the amplitude, and in the x-axis, we measure the time. One small segment measures 0.04 second, and 5 constitutes 0.2 seconds. And amplitude in vertically is 1 mm per segment. So 10 constitutes the 10 mm. Steps in ECG interpretation, first and foremost is the standardization. I will show in the subsequent slides. Second is the P wave amplitude, duration, and axis. Others are PR interval, QRS amplitude, axis duration, Q wave length, ST segment and T wave abnormalities, QT interval, heart rate, and rhythm. This is normal cardiac conduction. Cardiac conduction starts with the P wave. This is the P wave. This is the PR segment. Don't confuse with the PR interval. PR interval is from the beginning of P wave and beginning of QRS complex. PR segment is end of the P wave to beginning of the QRS segment. This is the QRS from the beginning of Q to end of the S is the QRS segment. QT interval is from start of the Q to end of the T. ST interval is different. We will not go into the detail. ST segment is from end of the S to beginning of the T. And RR interval is between two RR segments. How do we calculate the rate? Simplest is to measure the boxes between two RR interval. Suppose if we are counting a small one, 5, 5, 5, 5, and 5 total, then divide total number of the small boxes, 1500 divided by the small boxes. So suppose is between these two are the 15 in number, then the 1500 divided by 15 will be 100 beats per minute. If any question is there in between, please let me know. I was talking about the standardization. This is the normal ECG. On the right or left side, we will see this box. This is a normal standardization of 10 segments, 10 small boxes. Before interpreting the ECG, we have to check this standardization. If it is half of this, then the voltage will be half. If it is more than 10, suppose sometimes we have to make it 20 if the voltages are very small. And sometimes we have to make this 5 when the voltages are very high. This is a normal sinus rhythm. As we can see, the every QRS is preceded by the P wave. And every QRS is followed by the T wave. I am not going to detail the sinus tachy or brady because everybody knows about this. First, next is the P wave. Are there P waves? P wave present or not? Do all the P waves are similar or there are some changes in the morphology? Occurs at regular interval or not? And whether there is one P wave before each QRS or not? Normal is when one P wave is before every QRS is normal P wave axis. The most important leads in which we have to see the P wave are lead 2 and lead B1. Normally the P wave amplitude is less than 3 mm. But the duration of P wave is in children and infants are different. In infant, the duration of normal P wave is less than 0.07 seconds and in children is less than 0.09 seconds. This is a cartoon showing this is a normal P wave in lead 2 and lead B1. Because the P wave is constitutes by the right atrial depolarization and left atrial depolarization. This is a normal P wave. If the LA or RA size are equal, then there is difficulty in seeing the left atrial component in lead 2. In right atrial enlargement, the first part is elongated and second part we can see in the depressed later part of the P wave. But in lead B1, there will be predominant P wave in lead B1. Left atrial, the second part of the P wave will be dome shaped. This is known as the M pattern. And the lead B1, the later part of the P wave that is below the baseline will be prominent. In both will be predominant. What are the criteria? More than 2.5 mm in the inferior leads. Second, third, and ABF are the inferior leads. And more than 1.5 mm amplitude in B1 constitutes the patient into right atrial enlargement. And left atrial enlargement, as we can see, there will be a P mitral or M-shaped pattern in lead 2. And there will be predominant second part of the P wave in lead B1. Related to this case, 5 days old neonate is deeply sinused and duct dependent pulmonary circulation. This is the X-ray. Anybody wants to make a comment? Chat on karna padega. Vipul sir.
Chat on hai sir. Chat on hai bilkul.
PG hai kya hamare class mein?
Hanji.
PG hai PG.
Nahi.
This is a huge cardiomegaly.
Vikram hai.
Vikram, any comment?
Sir, this is a chest X-ray showing.
Bolo. Vikram.
Hello. Sir, this is the chest X-ray showing cardiomegaly.
Which, what type of cardiomegaly is there? This is the deep right atrium and huge right ventricle. This is a massive cardiomegaly. Especially in this type of history, if we are seeing in a 5 days old with decreased stenosis, most likely is the Epstein anomaly. This is a classical ECG of Epstein anomaly patient in which we can see the small and peak P wave in lead 2. This is a known as Malian P wave. The classical ECG of Epstein anomaly. Another feature is in Epstein is QRS splintered, known as the splintered QRS.
Sir, काफी disturbance आ रहा है कहीं से sir. सुनाई नहीं दे रहा.
बस कोई नहीं, मैं बंद कमरे में हूँ.
किसी का
विपुल सर.
अच्छा नहीं चला अभी. Now it's good.
ठीक है, this is a splintered QRS classically seen in cases of Epstein anomaly. Slides are not moving. Coming to PR interval, as I already told, the beginning of P wave to beginning of QRS is the PR interval. The normal values are less than 3 years is difficult to remember, but you can remember less than 3 years is 0.08 and more than 16 years is 0.12 second is the normal. I did not go for detailed P wave assessment because there is a wandering pacemaker. There is a multifocal atrial tachycardia. There are different. This will create this presentation is very difficult and cumbersome. So I just keep the presentation in a simple way. Adolescent patient came with a history of palpitation and giddiness, X-ray, blood, and were normal, but there was severe LV dysfunction on echo. Yeah, Vikram, Dr. Vikram, I just took the classical ECGs only, but sometimes it may vary. As we can see, we are talking about the PR interval. This is a short PR interval, and there is slurring of QRS here and here. This is a classical ECG of WPW syndrome, and the treatment is beta blocker followed by RF ablation. Next case, 10-year-old female, known case of rheumatic heart disease, currently asymptomatic on secondary prophylaxis. We have to check on the PR interval only because we are dealing with the PR interval at this time. As we can see here, there is a prolonged PR interval, constant prolonged PR interval. This is classically seen in either in rheumatic heart disease or in cases of atrial septal defect. And some congenital heart disease like Epstein, AV canal, diastolic toxicity and hyperkalemia. Coming on the QRS duration, the duration varies with the age, short in infant and increases with the age. More than 0.08 second in infant, previously it was 0.01, and more than 0.1 second, previously it was 0.12 second in adults were abnormal, falls the patient into abnormal QRS. White QRS, as we all know, the pre-excitation, the bundle branch block, ventricular tachycardia, arrhythmias are having white QRS. Coming on the axis assessment, for that simply I am using lead 1 and ABF. This is a standard cartoon as we can see in each and every ECG class. Simply calculate the small boxes of lead 1 QRS segment. Suppose it is coming into 10 small segments and it is coming into 10. So we have to just assume from here to 10 segment, and we draw a perpendicular line here. Then this segment is normal axis, this is left axis, this is right axis, and this is the northwest axis or extreme right and left axis. This is the normal, others are abnormal. Or another method is isoelectric method, in which we have to see the limb lead, which is isoelectric, means when there is equal upper and lower segment of the QRS, R and S are equal, then the axis will be perpendicular to that lead. And QT interval, as we all know, we have to measure from beginning of the Q wave to end of the T wave. Either we have to make a tangential line across the along the T wave where it is cutting the horizontal line, it is the end of the T wave. The normal QTC should be less than 0.44 second. but it can be normal up to 0.49 second in first 6 months of life. The dictum is when, suppose I did not take the normal ECG here, I am going back. Suppose this is a normal ECG, the QRS, the end of the T wave is falling more than half, one, two, three, and four. If it is going more than two, suppose it is going away from here, then it may give a suspicion that patient is having long QT. It should not be more than half of RR interval. Then it is normal, otherwise it is abnormal. As you all know, QT interval is not reliable. We have to measure the QTC interval calculated by a formula known as the Wezet formula, QT divided by square root of RR interval. Long QT interval causes most common in pediatric age group, especially in neonatal phases, hypocalcemia. Many cases I have seen in last almost 4 years in NICU, in which there was a doubt if the patient is having long QTC in neonatal period along with bradycardia, sinus bradycardia. That was a classical presentation of long QTC in case of hypocalcemia. When the patient was treated for the calcium and vitamin D, the QTC was normal. Others are long QT syndromes like that JLN syndrome or Romanovod syndrome. A few drugs are mentioned. Short QT interval is seen in classically in hypercalcemia and digital is effect in pediatric age group. Coming on the ST segment, it should be isolectic. Means isolectic means it should have a constant horizontal line. There should not be up and down. Elevation or depression of 1 mm in limb lead, that is 1, 2, 3 ABR, ABL, ABF, and 2 mm in pericardial leads are normal. If there is downward slope of ST segment followed by biphasic inverted T wave, it is always pathological. Causes of pathological, after LRTI, URTI, there is a pericarditis is the most common and also seen in post-cardiac surgery patients. Others are digital. In fact, MI, but it is rarely seen in pediatric age group. Few words about the T wave, because it is an important thing in pediatric ECG. The configuration changes with the time, but it is normal when it goes with the QRS. In first week of life, especially in first 3 days of life, the T waves are upright throughout the precordial leads. After the first week, the T wave inverted in V1 to V3, especially in V1. It remains like that up to 8 years of age. In persistence to upright T wave in V1 beyond first week, it is always and always abnormal. Amplitude of normal T wave is 6 mm in limb lead and 10 mm precordial leads are normal. Dictum is T wave is tall if it exceeds 2/3 of the preceding QRS and is small if less than 1/8 of the preceding QRS. And it is best evaluated in V5 and V6. Causes, peak tall T wave is seen in hyperkalemia, inverted T wave in myocarditis in pediatric age group, and flat or low T wave in hypokalemia and digital effect. Potassium abnormalities, as we are seeing in ICU settings, hypokalemia when the potassium level is less than 2.5 millimole per liter, it shows the ECG changes in the form of prominent U waves. Generally, we cannot see the U wave in normal ECG, but if there is a hypokalemia is there, U wave can be seen. I will show in the next slide. Flat or biphasic T waves. ST segment depression is a classical feature in a hypokalemia, but as the potassium level falls, the PR interval prolongs and block can be there. This is a case with potassium of 1.7 millimole per liter. It is, as we can see here, there are ST segment depression with T wave inversion with prominent U wave. These are the prominent U waves. Here we can see this ST segment with T wave inversion, prominent U waves with long Q U interval in which you cannot measure the QT. In hyperkalemia, as the potassium level rises more than 6 millimole per liter, the changes are there. Important and foremost is the tall and peak P wave. It will seem like this when the potassium is more than 6. The prolongation of QRS and PR interval as the potassium level will increase and there will be disappearance of P wave. And ultimately, asystole can be there if the potassium is not corrected. This is a case with potassium level 7 millimole per liter in which we can see there are tall and peaked P wave, or T wave, sorry. Right. T wave in V2 and V3, V4. As the potassium level will increase, there will be white bizarre QRS complexes with long PR segment. Here somewhere is the P wave. Here somewhere is the P wave. Long PR segment with wide and bizarre QRS. This is a potassium level of 9.9 milliequivalent per liter with sine wave appearance. Few words about the Delis effect. Salvador Delis sagging appearance, in which there will be sagging of the ST segment with inverted T wave. This is a classical feature of Delis effect, not the toxicity. Toxicity will manifest in different way. But if these are the signs in the ECG, we can assure the patient is responding to the Delis. Flat and short QT interval. These are the two important features. First and third are the two important features. In this, we can see the QT interval, QTC or QT interval is very short. Delis toxicity manifests in the form of disturbances in the impulse generation and conduction. This can be in the form of prolonged PR interval, premature ventricular contraction, bradycardia, blocks, arrhythmias. In this, we can see that there are frequent PVCs are there in the initial part of the Delis toxicity, followed by paroxysmal atrial tachycardia with blocks are there. So these are the important features of Delis toxicity. Now coming on the common cases that we are seeing. Up to this time, any query? Because I am going to the cases directly.
Sir, Vipin is asking if there is any QT interval duration as per age.
As I told you, in the first 6 months of life, up to 0.49 second is normal. After that, 0.44 is up to 0.44 second is normal. There are flow chart that shows the different QT interval in different age group, but it's difficult to remember and very cumbersome.
The QTC 0.44 beyond 6 months is significant.
Significant.
And in adults, is it different?
In adults are different, but I don't know exactly the values right now.
Okay.
Okay. This is a case, neonate, 5 days old, came with a history of breathing difficulty with intermittent bradycardia with query, AV block. Echo showed severe LV dysfunction and was declared as a case of cardiomyopathy. When we examined, the patient was on CPAP. There was a need of CPAP with the heart rate is varying between 60 to 110 beats per minute. The dilated and dysfunctional left ventricle was there. ECG shows some important clue. Any comment on, sir? First, we have to see whether it is a sinus rhythm or not. As we can see, there is every QRS is preceded by the P wave. Axis. As we all know, the 5 day old child, this is a negative, this is the positive in ABF, almost positive, matlab mix. So this is a negative is showing the patient is in the left lower quadrant, right lower quadrant. The patient is having right axis. For neonate, right axis is normal, but there is a prolonged QT interval. The Q wave is here, it is ending here. As we can see that if we are counting this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, almost 5 big boxes are there. The QT, the T wave should end 1, 2 somewhere here, but it is ending here. So that is crossing more than half of the RR interval. This clearly, there is no need to calculate for confirming whether the patient is having prolonged QTC or not. It is a clear cut case of long QTC. The calcium was low, but with vitamin D was also low with normal magnesium parathyroid. Vitamin D level of mother was also low. There was history of poor intake of calcium and vitamin D during pregnancy. But the child neonate was also having the same issue in the after birth. Patient was given supplement in the form of IV calcium and vitamin D. Gradually the function improved and ECG improved. And the prognosis of this long QTC is very good if it occurs after calcium deficiency. This is the follow-up ECG of the same patient in which we can see that there is a normal QTC after treatment. Another patient that I took in recent article in published in one cardiology of young in June issue, 14-year-old male came with a history of loss of consciousness while playing basketball. There was no significant family history. Patient came into the cardiac arrest and resuscitated for 15 minutes, and defibrillation was used 2 times for the ventricular fibrillation. troponin level was high, with ECG showing beats of 56 beats per minute and QTC duration of 320. Here you are seeing that QTC is very low, short QT. These are very rarely seen in day-to-day practice. This is an ECG of that patient that I took from the article. The QTC is very low here. The patient was, there is no definite treatment for short QTC, but if the patient is having aborted episode of cardiac arrest with sustained ventricular tachycardia fibrillation, implantable cardioverter deflator is the treatment of choice to avoid that shock episode.
Gaurav, is there any criteria for short QT as well? Like we have it for 0.44 is the upper limit. Is there a lower limit for normal QT?
No, sir.
Okay.
No, sir.
Okay.
Another type of long QT issue is 3-year-old with loss of consciousness, recurrent episode since last 1 year, mostly with exercise. Here, important history is mostly with exercise, never at rest or prolonged standing. There is no murmur, cardiac examination is normal, echo x-ray was normal, and BP is also normal. Again, a classical example of type 1 long QTC syndrome. Here you can see the T wave is ending here more than half of the RR interval. So means I want to say the patient can have recurrent history of syncope also with exercise. Another type of long QTC like 2 and 3. 3 generally occurs with the sleeping and 2 in between. Right flex sign in syncope, then we have to evaluate for cardiac, chest pain, dyspnea, palpitation or some form of structural heart disease. Syncope during exercise is always and pathological. With swimming, loud noises or sleep is typical of long QT syndrome. If there is any family history of deafness, with any family history of sudden death. These are the red flag signs that we evaluate for cardiac. This is a case that I encountered in January last year in NICU. 16 days old newborn came on ventilator for cardiorespiratory failure for 2 days. They were tachycardia with the low blood pressure, low capillary filling time with poor urine output. Broad axial was showing cardiomegaly. Heart rate was 296 beats per minute. Regular tachycardia was there with LV function of only 10 to 15%. Otherwise, cardiac structure was normal. That was the ECG recorded at that time. As you can see, the narrow QRS tachycardia is there. QRS is less than 0.08 seconds, almost 0.06 seconds. There is no visible P wave clearly. We can see anywhere. This is a classical ECG of supraventricular tachycardia. By this ECG, I am not sure whether it is ABRT or ABNRT. But this is a classical supraventricular tachycardia. Adenosine was given, but there was no significant effect. DSVT was there. Initial, we started with the IV metoprolol, but there was not significant response. Then we started oral flecainide. By giving oral flecainide, there was prolonged long QT at that time. So flecainide, we have to stop. Then we started the amiodarone also. But there was again long QT. Ultimately, we have to keep that neonate on IV metoprolol. Now the patient is almost 1 year old, more than 1 year old, and is on propranolol. Follow-up ECG showed the WPW syndrome of that neonate. So we have to keep the patient on beta blocker for at least 4 to 5 years because Indian setup, it is difficult to do RF ablation in less than 5 years of age. Another case, 1.5 month, history of feeding difficulty. Is in the respiratory distress with poor pulses, hypotensive, shock with LV function of 10 to 15%. As the history, this is a newborn, came into the shock like state. Here we can see there is a deep U wave in 1 and ABL. Important things are 1 and ABL and V5 and V6. But in V5 and V6 is difficult to see, but in 1 and ABL it is clearly shown. It is a classical feature of deep Q wave in lead 1 and ABL along with V5 and V6 are the classical feature of L kappa. And the treatment is only and on only surgery. We can do the medical management, but patient will not improve until unless we are doing the surgery for that patient because the infection will not improve by medical management. Another case, 2 days old neonate, with a heart rate of 58 beats per minute, regular. Normal sinus rhythm. Patient is in respiratory distress, in heart failure with CPAP support, cardiomegaly with LV function of 20%. Any comment? It is a sinus rhythm or not?
Block लग रहा है सर.
Block है.
Because we can see there is a regular P wave here. One, two, regular interval. There is no relation of P with the QRS. Here P is followed by QRS with short like this. And here P wave is not followed by the QRS. P wave is occurring at constant interval and there is no relation of QRS with the P wave. This is a classical example of complete heart block in neonatal age group. The treatment is only and only pacemaker. Up to 10 kg, the treatment of pacemaker treatment is only by epicardial technique, by open heart surgery. Otherwise, more than 10 kg, we can use the transvenous techniques as we are using in the adults. Treatable causes of LV dysfunction in neonates: L kappa, severe left-sided obstructions like palpitation and aortic stenosis, tachycardiomyopathies or bradycardiomyopathies like complete heart block, hypocalcemia and hypertension rarely in case of palpitation of aorta. Another case, 10-year-old male, asymptomatic, came with a history of abnormal murmur with wide and fixed split on the left second heart sound, widely split and fixed. Classical X-ray of large ASD. We can see the right atrium is dilated, right ventricle is dilated with pulmonary plethora. Any comment on the ECG? It is rarely seen in case of large ostium secundum ASD. As we can see here, there is some notching of the QRS segment, especially seen in inferior leads, lead 2, 3 and ABF. 3 and ABF are clearly shown. This is known as the crochet sign. It is classically seen in secondary type of ASD, but it is not always seen. And there is RSR in V1. That indicates the patient is having dilated right ventricle. This crochet sign is there. Another patient with a 2-year with cardiomegaly, there is end systolic murmur at the apex, but ejection systolic murmur and in the second left intercostal space. What is the difference here? There is a normal sinus rhythm. Every QRS is preceded by the P wave. But lead 1 is positive. Lead ABF is negative, mainly negative. The patient is having left axis. This is a case of ASD, but the axis is different. In the previous ECG, the axis either was normal or will be on the right side. But in this, the axis is left because the lead 1 is positive and lead ABF is negative. This is classically seen in primum type of ASD. Or defect, but because ASD is only secondum, others are the defect like primum defect, sinus venosus defect, or coronary sinus defect. These are not classified as the ASD. Left axis is seen in either in primum defect or AV canal type of defect. So the ECG axis with a clinical history can assess the patient is having some form of defects, but not the secondum type of ASD. Now, another ECG, 3-month-old infant with murmur, poor weight gain, difficulty in feeding. Classical left to right shunt lesions findings are there. Here we can see the V2 and V3. Because the standardization is normal, that's why the leads are getting overlapped. The voltages are getting overlapped. These are classical V2 and V3 are having equiphasic complexes. These are seen in case of large VSD, in which both the ventricles are getting the same amount of volume and both are equally dilated. It is seen in, it is known as the Katz-Wetzel phenomena. It is seen in case of large VSD. 6-month-old with loud ejection systolic murmur, mainly on the right upper sternal border and at the apex. Any comment? Sinus or non-sinus? It is sinus because every QRS is preceded by the Q wave. And here we can see the voltages are very high in V5 and V6 with negative inverted T wave in V5 and V6. This is inverted T wave is always signifies that LV is in the strain. With large R wave in V5 and T wave in the S wave in the V1, it is indicated in the LVH with strain. Suppose the voltages are high in V5 and V6. R wave is high in V5, V6 and S wave in V1 and V2. But the T wave is not inverted. It is upright, for example. then it will indicate LV is dilated or hypertrophic, but without strain. The negative P wave always indicates the LV is in the strain. Case of severe aortic stenosis, treatment is in case of valvular ballooning, otherwise surgery is the treatment of choice. 2 month male with sudden history of sudden cyanosis with defecation in the morning, sleeping saturation documented was 84% with ejection systolic murmur at left upper external border. Classical cartoon taken from the Google is cyanotic spell. Any comment? You have to see V1 and V2 only. I am just giving a hint, V1 and V2. As we can see, although the child is 2 months old, the V1 is having the prominent R wave with inverted T wave. Inverted T wave can be normal, but the V1 is having large amplitude. But there is sudden transition from V1 to V2 in which the R wave is small and S wave is predominant. It is classically seen in tetralogy of Fallot or anything that is having like double outed right ventricle in which the infundibulum is having some issue with pulmonary stenosis. But this is not although it is clearly stated that it is a classical ECG of tetralogy of Fallot, but sometimes we are not seeing this type of ECG in classical cases of tetralogy of Fallot also. In which if the pulmonary stenosis is not severe, then it will not be seen. The voltages will be high in case of V5 and V6, in which the pulmonary venous return is high. TOF is not always associated with the severe pulmonary stenosis. The definition of TOF is anterior deviation of the coronal septum, not the large VSD, PS, as the four things are written in the books. But the definition is anterior deviation of the coronal septum is the tetralogy of Fallot. It may or may not be associated with the pulmonary stenosis. Another ECG in which here we can see the axis is right. V1 is negative, lead one is negative, ABF is positive. The axis is right. Here the one is positive and ABF is negative. QRS is this and the P wave is prominent here. The axis is negative, but the patient is cyanosed. This is 1 month old, deeply cyanosed, second heart sound was single. Classically seen in either case of tricuspid atresia because the voltages are not there, will not capture from the right ventricle because the RV is hypoplastic, or in case of pulmonary atresia intact ventricular septum in which the RV is hypoplastic. The axis will be left always because the RV is not giving anything to the ECG. The axis will be left always. So axis sometimes can tell in cyanotic patient whether it is a tetralogy of Fallot in which the right axis will be there, or it can be either pulmonary atresia intact ventricular septum or tricuspid atresia if the axis is left sided. 2 year old asymptomatic abnormal sound on the right side of the heart. X-ray showing the situs solitus here and the dextrocardia is here. Here we can see the P wave is positive in one. It should be positive in V1 in case of situs solitus and the negative in the AVR. It is normal. But the voltages are getting decreased as we are going away from V1 to V6 because the leads are placed normally as we normally place in case of levocardia. The voltages will decrease as the lead will go away from the heart. This is a classical ECG of situs solitus dextrocardia. But here the patient is having situs inversus with dextrocardia. The lead one is having negative P wave, but AVR is having the positive P wave. This indicates the patient is having situs inversus and the voltages are gradually down as we go from the V1 to V6. So this is classically seen in situs inversus dextrocardia. By seeing the one and AVR, we can at least assess whether the patient is having situs solitus or not. Sometimes it can be misleading V1 to V6 whether the patient is having dextrocardia or not, but situs inversus we can see classically by ECG only. Classical ECG of pericarditis, it can occur after cardiac surgery also or after viral infection also, in which there is a upright ST segment in V2, V3 with corresponding ST segment depression in opposite leads. Here is the ST segment is upright and lead 2 is also getting upright ST segment. It will gradually subside as the time will pass. Electrical alternance. It is seen in case of cardiac tamponade Because here one is the QRS is normal, another is small. Because the heart is swinging in the pericardium in case of cardiac tamponade, this will give this finding. To summarize, ECG is useful in identifying situs and cardiac position, helpful in assessing many of the congenital heart diseases, aids in assessing volume and pressure overloads, identifies electrolyte imbalance, and LCAP and tachypraedia should always be ruled out in case of dilated cardiomyopathy cases. Thank you. If any question is there, I will be more happy to answer.
Bahut badhiya, Gaurav, excellent presentation.
Thank you, sir.
Total comprehensive, first class. पूरा बच्चों की तरह पढ़ाया तूने, थोड़ा सा एक बारी में हमारे को सारा रिकैप्सुलेट करना मुश्किल है।
मुश्किल है सर, मैंने तो बहुत सिंपल रखा है इसको इसी वजह से ना,
क्योंकि नहीं, 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 वेरी नाइस, वेरी नाइस केसेस, वंडरफुल ईसीजीज, ऑल इलेक्ट्रोलाइट इंबैलेंसेस एंड योर कंजेनिटल डिसऑर्डर्स एंड मायोकार्डाइटिस, पेरिकार्डाइटिस, बहुत बढ़िया।
थैंक यू सर।
फॉर्चूनेटली सुनने वाले सारे सुपर स्पेशलिस्ट हैं तुम्हारे यहाँ मेरे को और विपुल और मन को छोड़ के चलो अच्छी
सर, ये समझ तो आ जाता है पर फिर भूल जाता है,
याद नहीं रहता बाद में,
देखते रहो तभी याद रहेगा ना यार,
अदरवाइज नहीं याद रहता।
टू कोरिलेट इट बिकम्स डिफिकल्ट एंड डोंट बी कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव,
कम से कम 2-3 घंटे चाहिए पूरा पढ़ाने के। हाँ बिल्कुल, तीन पार्ट्स में आराम से कर सकते हैं।